I'm Jeff Collins, and it's my great pleasure to introduce tonight's guest. Cihan Tuğal is Associate Professor of Sociology at the University of California, Berkeley, where he studies socioeconomic change, religion, and politics. His first book, Passive Revolution, Absorbing the Islamic Challenge to Capitalism, studied the rise of liberal Islam and its popularization among the poor and erstwhile revolutionaries. In his newest book, The Fall of the Turkish Model, he explores Islamic movements and regimes in Turkey, Egypt, Tunisia, and Iran, revealing the dynamics behind the fall of liberalism across the Middle East. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Cihan Tuğal for a conversation about the rise and fall of the so-called Turkish model of government and what it means for the future of Turkey as well as other countries in the Middle East. Cihan, thank you for joining us. I thought we could start with Turkey's domestic situation. So last week, those of you in the audience may have read the news that the Prime Minister of Turkey, Ahmet Davutoğlu, announced that he would be resigning. Davutoğlu was a longtime loyalist of Turkey's president and former Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan. And as Erdogan's foreign policy advisor, Davutoğlu became known for his zero problems with neighbors policy, and Erdogan later appointed him as foreign minister. So I think Davutoğlu's resignation was no surprise for close observers of Turkey. He had been exhibiting some policy differences with Erdogan on key issues, and it's long been clear that Erdogan does not tolerate dissent or independence. So Cihan, you've written extensively about the promise of AKP and the so-called Turkish model and how that promise has evaporated under Erdogan. Can you introduce us to the Turkish model? What is it? What happened to it? And what does Davutoğlu's resignation say about it?
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. This is an exciting but also a depressing topic to talk about. There seemed to be so much hope in the last years throughout the region, and now we see that hope not simply dwindling but evaporating. And I would like to start with a very short definition of what I mean by the Turkish model and liberal Islam, because I don't use this word liberal in the American sense, but rather in the British sense of free market policies plus some cultural and political freedoms. But when it comes to the Turkish model, the cultural political freedoms aspect is a little downplayed. So what the Turkish model consists of was a combination of a restricted form of liberal democracy, and I'll try to come to that, what I mean by those restrictions, free market policies introduced into a mixed economy, and conservative Islam, but a toned-down conservatism when compared to the Islamist movement of the preceding decades. So what happened in the first two terms of the AKP, roughly from 2002, the cutting date is not very clear, maybe 2010, 2011, was that the free market policies that the center-right had been pushing in Turkey for the last 60 years in a lot of fluctuating and troublesome manner became much more common sense and successful and smoothly implemented with the AKP's rise. So the free market was never that popular, perhaps with the little exception of the mid-1980s. And under the AKP or AK Party, as it is known in Turkey, the free market became very popular among broad sectors of society, but of course not all sectors of society. So this also included a very tough, aggressive struggle against civil servants and especially organized labor, not the working class as a whole, perhaps, but organized labor. So the social groups who had been benefiting from mixed economic policies and some protectionism. And the AK Party built its popularity, therefore, on emergent business classes and middle classes, but also the very poor of the poor, who had been excluded from the formal mixed economy. So this was not simply, one upper class against one lower class, but a mismatch of certain strata, but definitely strata that benefited from free market policies against strata who benefited from the mixed economy of the especially pre-1980 era. So what happened? Why did this model start to degenerate, and why was it ultimately dropped? So the primary structural reason behind all of this is the downturn in the world economy. So after 2008, there were less commodities circulating, less hot money circulating, and Turkey could no longer benefit from the Turkish free market economy could no longer benefit from the speculative booms in the world economy. So the government turned more and more to cultural and political promises to solidify its base. So that's a very broad structural observation. And I would argue that the same kind of trend partially at least explains the sharp right-wing turn in European politics and possibly in the coming years, American politics. But that's only a part of the picture. There is something more specific to Turkey, and that was the business class, the pious new business class, not only perpetrated but partially created by this regime, which had its hopes in an opening in the Middle East, a further opening to business, a further opening to international trade. And the governing party and its business class became especially hopeful about this during the Arab Spring. And Erdogan and his business coterie organized more and more trips to the Middle East and especially Egypt, where they tried not only to sell the Turkish model as an ideal, but also Turkish business itself. And when the Arab Spring ultimately failed, this energy was sort of turned inwards, but not in a very productive manner. So the government had to give or promise other things to this once really energetic business class. So another factor that has to be integrated into the explanation is the right-wing turn in Europe itself. Because the European Union was, or the promise to the accession, promise of accession to Europe was one of the factors that allowed Islamists in Turkey to make peace with this free market conservative Islamic model. And once Europe swung to the right and decided to close its doors to Turkey, the government and its Islamist base felt more and more isolated and had less hopes in further liberalization. And the last missing piece of the puzzle, which tends to be less emphasized in the academic and journalistic explanations out there, is the integration of the Islamist cadres and discourses themselves during the successful two terms of the AKP, which seemed to work well in the beginning. But after everything else started to go wrong, these once integrated and relatively peaceful cadres, previous Islamist cadres who had started to downplay their Islamism, they turned once again toward Islamism, to their ideological, social roots in Islamism, and they pushed the government too. So it wasn't just Erdogan himself and his character, but these cadres who had been integrated, who pushed Turkey in this more Islamist direction, especially after the failure of the Arab Spring.
Thank you, Cihan. That was a great introduction. You mentioned former Prime Minister, now President Erdogan, several times. I think he's a big key to the puzzle that is Turkey. Over his time as Prime Minister, he really consolidated power within the AKP, but also became really the all-powerful player in Turkey. essentially sidelining the military and the opposition parties. Can you talk a little bit about how Erdogan fits into what has happened, what's happening in Turkey? And as I understand it, he still remains quite popular. What does he mean for what's happening in Turkey, and why is he still popular among the majority?
Yeah, there are many reasons for his popularity, and if we understand that, then we can also understand why he was so easily able to sideline and then dismiss, basically fire. I mean, we say he resigned, but Davutoğlu was fired from his job, to be honest. So how was he able to do that? Why was he able to do that? Davutoğlu is a serious intellectual, a serious academic with very solid grounding in foreign policy, international relations theory. How can someone of this stature be so easily fired from his job? And the reason basically is Erdogan's popularity, and there are many reasons for that popularity. And all of these reasons, all of these factors are lacking in Davutoğlu's and similar figures on past. It's true that Erdogan is a conservative and religious figure, and that partially explains his popularity. But there are many religious and conservative leaders in Turkey, and arguably Davutoğlu himself is one. So that's not the only reason. The more sociological reason for this is his roots in an urban poor neighborhood, and his family's roots in the Black Sea region, so essentially in the provinces of Turkey. So the poor, the people in the provinces have a lot to relate to. Okay, so people from the Black Sea or from Central Eastern Anatolia see themselves in him. The poor see themselves in him. They can't see themselves in people like Abdullah Gül, the previous president who was more liberal than Erdogan. They can't see themselves in Davutoğlu, but they can see themselves in Erdogan. And this is not simple sociological reductionism, because he reproduced those social roots in the provinces and in poor neighborhoods through continuous political engagement with the poor, with the provinces, throughout his political career. So I would add that, just like Trump, you know, sells himself as a plain-spoken person, tough guy, Erdogan does the same, and this, you know, easily makes a politician popular among certain sectors of society. So this is a factor too. But unlike Trump, he is coming from a political career. So what Trump wants to enjoys to flesh out is his lack of engagement in politics, right? With Erdogan, it's the reverse. He is coming from a political career, but not from the political establishment. So it's more social movement politics or street politics. So it's not, you know, politics in, you know, Washington, D.C. or Ankara, but it's a kind of political career that allowed him to interact with people of all kinds, not just the poor and people from the provinces, but people of all kinds throughout his life. So he's very much able to hold the pulse of a crowd whenever he speaks. You know, when he loses the pulse, he immediately senses it and readjusts himself. I've seen him speak in poor neighborhoods, and I've never seen any speaker like him. So that sociological background plus that political experience makes him very, very exceptional and sets him apart from all these alternatives, such as Abdullah Gül and Ahmet Davutoğlu and other Islamist figures we can, you know, go into.
There's obviously a significant minority that opposes Erdogan. What are some of their beefs with Erdogan, and why haven't they, the opposition parties, done or been able to do something to take power?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because that's also a part of his appeal, the lack of appeal of the opposition. So what unites the opposition in Turkey, and yes, it is a significant minority, it's close to half of the population. Close to half of the population more than hates Erdogan. Okay, they strongly, deeply hate Erdogan. Okay, so it's not any simple hatred, it's deep hatred. So how is he able to, you know, weather that? Well, his primary asset is the incompetency of the opposition. But this incompetency is not just the personal incompetency of the politicians of the opposition, it's much more structural than that. They have no alternative. They have nothing to replace Erdogan's policies with. So the most that the Republican People's Party, the CHP, can propose is, we're just going to be like the first two terms of the AKP. I mean, they literally promised this to the people when you read in between the lines. And this is such a poor promise, because why would you go for the fake thing when you have the real thing? And the other opposition party, the Nationalist Action Party, which is a far right-wing nationalist party, promises the reverse. We're just going to do what Erdogan is doing now, but we're going to do it better than him. Why believe any of this when you had both with Erdogan, right? So the opposition has nothing to offer, and this is a pretty big asset for Erdogan.
So many people in Turkey and observers of Turkey, I think, saw some hope in Turkish civil society providing a counterbalance to Erdogan when the opposition parties were feckless. And there was some hope in the summer of 2013 around the what are known as the Gezi Park protests. And at that time, very heterogeneous mix of groups came together to protest Erdogan and the government. You've written about this. And as you've said in your book, this movement essentially withered away and didn't fulfill the promise that it had. So can you tell us a little bit about what happened with the promise of civil society providing a balance to Erdogan, and where does it stand today?
Okay, that's also very important, because yes, these two establishment parties, the Nationalist Action Party and the Republican People's Party, had nothing to offer, but perhaps, you know, something coming from the street could do something else, because ultimately Erdogan himself and the AKP itself came from street politics. So in the beginning, there was a hope, there was a promise in the Gezi protests, because that was also something real and authentic. But it didn't work out, because the Gezi protests in 2013 could never come up with an agenda. Okay, so it's not simply not producing a counter Erdogan, but also not producing a counter party that ultimately hurt Gezi. The closest thing that came to this was the Kurdish party, which now claims to be all of Turkey's party, not just the Kurds party. And the Kurdish party now argues that it actually incorporates all of the promises of Gezi: environmentalism, pro-LGBT rights, democratization, as well as Kurdish rights. The problem is, whether the party is sincere about this or not, which is another discussion, the problem is nobody believes this. And whether they are sincere about this, whether that party is sincere about this or not, they did not do a very good job at selling this promise, marketing this promise. Whereas the AKP was successful from the beginning in selling whatever it was selling. First it was liberal Islam, now it's nationalist Islam. But in marketing it, it's very successful. And this is not just a coincidence, because it builds on these cadres and discourses, including people like Erdogan, that have been maturing ever since the 1970s. And on the Kurdish side, or on the side of the liberals and the left, there is no counterpart of this. There is no strong rooted movement, except the Kurdish guerrilla, which we can later come to. Except the Kurdish guerrilla, there is no movement that can cut across Turkey that has been organizing itself and its cadres and discourses ever since the 1970s. So when Gezi erupted, it excited a lot of people, especially because of the promise that it could replace Erdogan with something, that it could overthrow Erdogan. But just like the other two establishment parties, it ended up offering nothing concrete. So no agenda, no promise. Well, people stuck to the governing party.
Cihan, let me ask you one more domestic question, then we'll turn to some of Turkey's international issues, and then we will work in some questions from the audience. So you talked in the beginning a bit about the economic rise of Turkey being important to AKP becoming powerful and Erdogan consolidating power. What happens if the Turkish economy tanks to Erdogan and the AKP?
Yes, I think that's a very important question. That's always a danger waiting around the corner for the regime, and it might happen anytime. I mean, if there's a sharper, more intense version of 2008, globally, Turkey might get hurt too, and that would seriously damage the governing party's ability to govern. But I would not predict, and it's hard to predict anything like this, but my sense, my educated guess, would be that this would not necessarily dethrone the party. It would just make it more aggressive, more nationalist, and perhaps it could lead to a civil war where, again, the regime probably wins.
Got it. So let's talk about some of Turkey's international issues. And if you just look at the map, the countries in Turkey's neighborhood demonstrate how many issues and challenges there are. I'm very interested in Turkey's and Erdogan's position on ISIS. So we hear a lot about ISIS in the United States, and I think there's a belief from the international community that Turkey is not really pulling its weight against ISIS. So can you tell us a bit about why Turkey doesn't necessarily see ISIS as an existential threat, and how does ISIS fit into their foreign policy?
First of all, officially the regime says it does see the ISIS as an existential threat, but when you look at the actual policies, when you look at what it's doing, it's very clear that it doesn't. I mean, when you look at the people, the number of people arrested for ISIS activities versus the number of people arrested for Kurdish activities, the gap is very clear. The number of people killed for ISIS activities by Turkey versus the number of people killed for Kurdish activities, again, the gap is very clear. So it is very clear who the real enemy is for Turkey. But of course, a lot of people are claiming that it's not just a gap. Turkey is actively cooperating with ISIS, some people argue. And there's a lot of ground to believe this. Just a simple internet search would tell you a lot about this. So most recently, two primary journalists who claimed they have found proof for this support and support of other jihadis have been on trial. And these are one of them is one of Turkey's prominent journalists. So it seems that there is this relationship between Turkey and at least al-Nusra, if not ISIS, and Turkey has been trying to cover up. So why is this happening? Well, the very simple explanation is that Turkey perceives, or I should say the Turkish regime perceives a Shia agenda in the Middle East, a Shia crescent that has been willingly or unwillingly supported by the West in the recent years. And against this Shia crescent, Turkey is trying to build a Sunni bloc with Saudi Arabia, the Gulf countries, and the jihadis they are supporting. And ISIS is a wild card here because it's never clear who ISIS is armed by and supported by. People speculate it's Qatar, it's Saudis, or some Saudi families, and ultimately Turkey. But whether that is right or not, it is very clear that the Sunni jihadis are a part of this project of building a Sunni bloc against the Shia crescent. And the other less global issue is the Kurdish issue. ISIS constitutes the strongest threat against the Kurds. Okay. So Syria, the Syrian regime is no longer a threat against the Kurds. The Iraqi regime is not. And who knows what Iran is doing. So ISIS is a natural ally in that sense because it has been, you know, bombing, massacring, etc., the Kurdish population. So in that regard, it looks like a natural ally. So I would say those are the two primary reasons. But one more thing to add, there is growing resonance between the beliefs and aims, if not the methods, of the Turkish regime and ISIS. So, you know, building Islamist strength all over the world. Right. So they converge more and more as time unfolds in terms of their overall aims, even if they still disagree about the methods.
So you've pointed to an area of disagreement between the United States and the Turkish government. I guess there's several. One is on ISIS, the other is the fight against Syria, and these differences relate to the Kurdish issue and the PKK in Turkey. I want to ask you about another difference that the United States and Turkey have, and that's on Egypt. So Turkey supported the Muslim Brotherhood government in Egypt as a moderate democratic alternative to the Mubarak regime. And what Turkey argues now is that Egypt and the situation there shows that the U.S. has a double standard on democracy. And so Turkey argues that the U.S. criticizes Turkey for human rights shortcomings in Turkey while at the same time supporting the current al-Sisi authoritarian regime in Egypt. And so my question to you is, does Turkey have a point in this criticism of the U.S.?
Yes, it does. And, you know, we could come up with a long list of American and European conspiracies regarding the Middle East. It's not just Egypt. It's Turkey itself, too, because, you know, when you look at when the European Union decided to grant or, you know, started to think about granting a visa right to Turks, it was in Turkey's most authoritarian period rather than its democratizing periods, right? So both Europe and the United States have been very hypocritical throughout these years for almost all Middle Eastern countries, and another prominent case is Saudi Arabia. It's not just Egypt. So Turkey does have a point in that regard. The Turkish regime does have a point. But we should not forget... And I must add, in passing, even though I don't have time to expand on this, the Sisi regime is even more brutal than Mubarak at this point. So, yeah, Turkey does have a very strong point. But let's look at the other side of the coin, the short tenure of the Muslim Brotherhood. What did the Muslim Brotherhood do when it was in power and was not only being supported by Turkey, but being advised by Turkey? And I can expand on that later. There were very specific methods by which Turkey advised the Muslim Brotherhood. And I'm not sure they heeded all the advice. But what was the Brotherhood what was it doing when it was being led by Turkey? Well, it was cooperating with the military and with Tantawi, the military leader of Egypt, in suppressing the street protests that were calling for democratization, in suppressing labor protests, and even voting in minor districts, labor districts in Egypt, like Al-Mahalla Al-Kubra. So the Muslim Brotherhood was itself a pro-military governmental alternative to the military. Right? So it was never really an alternative.
Fascinating. So let's continue our tour around Turkey's neighborhood, and then we'll turn to some audience questions. So next, let's talk a bit about Turkey-Israel. The relationship has been strained since the Mavi Marmara incident in 2010, and that was when a Turkish vessel was sailing to Gaza to protest the Israeli blockade of Gaza, and the Israeli forces boarded the ship. It resulted in some deaths. Diplomatic relations were cut off. Over the years, there's been, the last several years, been an effort backed by the United States government to get Turkey and Israel talking again. Those talks are now, they've been on again, off again. They're now proceeding at the ministerial level. What are the chances of Turkey and Israel achieving some kind of rapprochement, and where do you see the relationship heading?
Yeah, I would say there are some chances, but this is a very complex relationship. And I covered some of this in my book, and I'll cover more of it in my coming book about Islamic and Christian charity throughout history, in which I have a chapter on the organization that led to this crisis, the charitable organization that led to this crisis. So it was an Islamic charity organization that sent this ship, or its ship was in a bigger convoy heading for Israel/Palestine. And there's a very interesting balance here, because these people were supporting the AKP regime, but they thought the AKP did not do enough in fulfilling its Islamist promises to its Islamist base. So this was not just an action against Israel. The Mavi Marmara incident was not just an action against Israel. It was also an action to push the government to be more Islamic. And in this case, by being more pro-Palestine. So that was their agenda, but it was a part of a broader agenda. And it was a successful action from the perspective of this organization. And it really shows us how complex the the social political relations are in Turkey. You know, you can't reduce this authoritarian turn, the Islamist turn in Turkey, to Erdogan's personality or to the world economy or to the European Union question, all factors I have been talking about. But there was this serious Islamist civil society push. You know, we've been talking about secular civil society, but there's also a strong Islamist civil society in Turkey, and they pushed Turkey and the regime in this anti-Israel direction. And actually, very interestingly, this resulted in a fallout within the regime itself, because the most prominent cleric supporting the regime, Fethullah Gülen, parted ways with the government after this incident, because he's a cleric living in Pennsylvania, and he has very close ties with Washington and with Israel. But despite all of this, there are still very strong links between Turkey and Israel. Why? Because Turkey has a lot of business with Israelis. And not Turkey in general, but the Turkish regime, Erdogan and his extended family, they have business with Israel. So this is not going to go away soon. Anywhere, the chances to repair relations are still there, because both parties are heavily invested in each other due to business links and due to other common diplomatic concerns, such as their common anti-Shia crescent position.
We've been collecting some questions from the audience, and I'd like to start to work those in, especially as we finish or continue on these foreign policy international issues. One audience member asked, how can Turkey's issues with the PKK and the Kurds be solved? So you and I touched on the Kurdish issue. We've observed the last several years that the AKP under Erdogan was moving ahead with the peace process to solve the longstanding Kurdish issue in Turkey. That collapsed. Can you walk us through what has happened, and what's the status, and are there any prospects to solve the Kurdish issue?
Well, not anytime soon. just to give some credit to this regime, Erdogan and the people around him, and the AK Party, the AKP, were the only forces in Turkey's establishment, probably because they were coming from outside the establishment, that took the Kurds seriously in a positive manner. I mean, obviously you have to take the Kurds seriously, but in a positive manner, they were the only people to do this for a couple of years, 2-3 years. And that actually accounts for much of the hope among the intelligentsia, among the liberals of Turkey, the pro-AKP hope that, you know, that this is the party that can resolve this issue. And I can see the psychological, political grounding for that hope, but I never shared that hope. Actually, in my first book, I had called the Kurdish issue the underbelly of this very successful consent-driven regime. So this is the only place I had predicted where it's not based on consent, and it's going to the consent is going to collapse because of this. Not the regime, but its consent base is going to collapse because of this. And unfortunately, this happened. And now both parties, it's not just the regime, by the way, but forces within the Kurdish guerrilla, if not the whole organization, are pushing this more and more towards a violent conflict. So there are people, groups, cadres on both sides who see violence as the only way out. And they are sidelining, marginalizing, or purging anyone who doesn't. So this is also hurting the prospects of the Kurdish political party, who, as I said, was promising to be, you know, all of Turkey's party, not just the Kurds. But it's not credible anymore also because of this, because groups within the guerrilla have pushed for more violence. And in the beginning, the political party resisted this. You know, they said, we don't want to see this. But ultimately, they had to side with either of the forces. And of course, they wouldn't side with the state. They sided with the guerrilla. And this is also just a win-win game for the government itself. As it escalates the violence, it both hurts its real main opposition. I don't see the Republican People's Party and the Nationalist Action Party as real opposition. I mean, they basically don't exist anymore. But the real opposition are the Kurds. And by escalating the violence, the governing party is both destroying the Kurdish opposition, and it is also stealing more and more people from these two other parties. So anybody who strongly believes in Turkish nationalism and who strongly believes that the Kurdish political movement should be destroyed is investing its hopes in the governing party. So it is a win-win situation for mm-hmm. the government as well.
Let me ask you one more international question, and then we'll go back to Turkey's domestic situation. I think there's a lot of audience interest in what's happening domestically. You talked about the complexity in the Turkish-Israeli relationship. Let's talk a little bit about Iran, also a complex relationship. When I was serving in the White House, there was frustration in the U.S. government that Turkey was not doing enough to ensure that Iran was not violating U.S. and international sanctions and was even helping to facilitate some evasion of the sanctions. What did Turkey think about the U.S. agreement with Iran, and what is the Turkish perspective on Iran today?
Yes, another very interesting topic, because we see that both sides, I mean both the U.S. plus the West and Turkey, have completely switched their positions on this, right? So Turkey, in its liberal Islamic phase, was trying to push Iran too in a liberal Islamic direction. And this was a sincere, real hope. And the reasoning was straightforwardly liberal, in the British, not the American sense. So introduce free markets and people will loosen up, right? Common sense ever since John Locke. And they really believed it. And a lot of American liberals believe this too. A lot of, you know, center liberals in the U.S. believe this too, and they were supporting Turkey's position on this. But the more Islamist, Sunni Islamist Turkey became, the more it lost, the regime lost hope in liberalism. It turned against both these promises of liberalism and against Iran just because it was Shia. So this was sort of in the sociological makeup of the party already, even when it was liberal, its cadres and its supporters consisted almost exclusively of Sunni people. So there's a very large minority in Turkey. Some people say it's around 3 million. Some people exaggerate and say it's around 20 million. Probably it's somewhere in between, maybe 10 million people who are heterodox Shiites. Almost none of them, perhaps except, you know, a few hundred, vote for this party. They see this party as their main enemy in all of Turkey, okay? Because this is a strongly Sunni party, but it was downplaying its Sunni Sunni aspirations and Sunni sociological makeup in the 2000s. But after the Arab Spring, or with the Arab Spring, and after the downturn of the world economy, the party started to emphasize its Sunni identity more and more, and turned against Iran. And this is partially the reason why it turned against Syria too. Not the only reason, obviously, but one of the reasons. So this is not just an Islamist party, it's a Sunni Islamist party, and we should never forget that both sociological and political belonging mm-hmm. of this party.
We've done a really great tour around Turkey's neighborhood that shows how difficult its geography is and how it has to calibrate its foreign policy positions to achieve its goals. But I'd like to just to kind of close out this international discussion, ask you, what are Turkey's goals now in the region? So if we go back to our discussion of the Turkish model and Davutoglu's zero problems with neighbors policy, Turkey really had a desire to influence other regimes in the region and to have positive relations with those in its neighborhood. So now that things have become more violent and more difficult, what does Erdogan and the Turkish regime see as their goals in the region? And maybe you could also work into that the European Union, something we haven't talked about, because AKP was very much in favor of joining the EU, and that has kind of languished. So between Europe and the Middle East, what would you say are kind of the overarching goals of the Turkish regime now?
So the very broad goal was exporting the old Turkish model, so the Turkish model of the 2000s, liberal Islam, primarily to Egypt, and hopefully then to the rest of the Arab world after Egypt, through business links, through conferences, seminars that would educate these Arab leaders in how to implement this liberalization, etc., etc. But after 2013, especially after it turned out that none of this would work, the regime turned to a hard power approach, you know, dropping its soft power and influence approach. It turned to a hard power approach, and now the primary goal is overthrowing the Syrian regime and establishing a Sunni regime in Syria. And this is nothing original. And this is what is really hurting the regime internationally, because the previous goal was really in the monopoly of Turkey, in the monopoly of the Turkish regime, regionally speaking. So whenever the West looked for a liberal ally, it was Turkey. But establishing a Sunni regime in Syria, I mean, this has been the goal of the Gulf countries and Saudi Arabia from day one. And today, more than the Saudis, it's really Qatar's goal. So the Turkish regime is also pushing itself into a corner by adapting the agenda of a very small Gulf country, of a very small Gulf country that is punching above its weight. And now you have two countries, Turkey plus Qatar, still punching above their weight. And you can't just, you know, push Russia to the side and establish a Sunni regime in Syria. This is just impossible. So Turkey is aiming for something that is truly impossible mm-hmm. in the region and in Syria.
And how about Turkey's view toward European Union accession? What prospects do you see? And perhaps you could touch on the recent immigration discussions with Turkey and Europe and how they play into this.
Yes, so up until 2007, some people would say 2006, there seemed to be, again, I was one of the few who didn't believe this, but there seemed to be a real chance that Turkey could be accepted into Europe. It's not just that I didn't trust Turkey's democratic or democratizing credentials. I didn't trust the Europeans. I didn't trust Europeans would accept a Muslim partner into their midst. What happened after 2007 was that there was a thaw, okay? So the relations were not cut off immediately, but they got colder and colder up until the refugee crisis. And now there is this fake rejuvenation of the close ties between Turkey and Merkel, more than Europe, perhaps. Merkel and Erdogan, more than Turkey and Europe. So now Erdogan basically promises that he's not going to allow the Arabs into Europe. And in return, Europe is going to give Turkey some money, but also withdraw from criticizing its policies against Kurds. That's the implicit promise. The explicit promise is money and some visa rights. But the implicit promise is also very clear, because whenever somebody asks Merkel a question about the Kurds, she point blank says, of course, Turkey has the right to do that. Whereas, you know, no European leader would say that pre-refugee crisis. So again, talking about the hypocrisies of Europe, now this is a shared hypocrisy because both parties are playing a game as if, you know, there is a real chance of accession. But now, nobody believes us anymore, unlike the pre-2007 situation.
Let's return to Turkey's domestic situation and pick up with some questions from the audience. Several people have asked, what has happened to Ataturk's secular system and principles? To what extent do those exist, or are they disappearing? And one audience member asked it in this way: is Erdogan's real goal to make Turkey into an Islamic state governed primarily by Islamic precepts and policies? So can you comment on this notion that Erdogan and the AKP are trying to Islamicize Turkey?
Yes. Now this is an easier question to answer now, as opposed to 5 years ago, because now the government is very explicit about this. They do say they want to Islamize Turkey by Islamizing the younger generation. So they don't say they're going to set up Sharia courts tomorrow. I mean, that's not their line. Maybe that's their intention. Who knows? But they explicitly say that they're going to create a new generation and make Turkey Islamic through that new generation. They did not say that 5 years ago. And 5 years ago, the whole debate was around what is their real aim? Are they Islamists deep down inside? Are they hiding themselves? Or did they really liberalize? And I should admit that I was on the side of those who were saying, no, they are not deep down Islamists. They did seriously liberalize. And I turned out to be wrong, at least on surface. Now, the Kemalists were saying, no, they're just hiding themselves. They're just waiting to monopolize power, and then they're going to impose Sharia. And now what I think really happened was, yeah, they did liberalize, but their liberalization was contingent upon all of these factors. The commodity boom throughout the world, European accession, and the promise that the Kurds could be put down, the Kurdish insurgency could be put down. When these did not work, they ultimately dropped their liberalization. And yes, the party, the regime, is building an Islamic country. It's not going to be the same as Iran or Saudi Arabia or Afghanistan, but it is going to resemble Saudi Arabia more and more. Not in all of the details. I don't think Sharia courts are going to take over anything anytime soon. But the issue is, the government is very explicit. It has no apologies on this front, that it is trying to make everybody more conservative, not just the policies, but people themselves. So this has become a very explicit agenda.
It's really amazing how much things have shifted in a short time. So I served in Turkey from 2006 to 2009, and when I went to Ankara, the big debate was around the headscarf, and that was a hot button issue. It was territory that no one could cross, requiring women or allowing women to wear a headscarf in public institutions, school teachers, government offices. That changed several years later, and now it's essentially accepted. Isn't that right?
Yeah, it's accepted, encouraged too. So not enforced, but encouraged.
What are some other examples of how the government's conservative, religious views that are more open now, how is that affecting people? And some things that come to mind, one thing that comes to mind for me would be alcohol consumption. Mm-hmm. How has that changed? Is there pressure on people to not drink in certain cities?
Yeah, well, that pressure was there from the beginning socially. I mean, in certain towns, in certain cities, especially in the countryside, there was always social pressure. What's changing now, or what has been changing in the last few years, is that municipal buildings universities, social clubs of universities, they have stopped serving alcohol. I mean, they legally can't anymore. So there are certain policy changes, it's not just social. But I don't think that's the most worrying thing. I mean, not drinking alcohol won't kill you. What will kill you is if courts, and you don't need Sharia courts for this, if courts just let people go when they kill their wives, yeah, that will kill you. And in the last 10 years, there's more and more examples of this. So violence against women has been just normalized. Not by people saying, you know, just go kill your wife. I mean, nobody's going to do that, right? But if the courts are reluctant to punish people, then that sends a very clear message. You don't have to tell people to punish their wives. They will.
And how about the LGBTQ community, something that's important here in the Bay Area? I recall when I was in Turkey, at the end of my term, President Obama visited, and one of my responsibilities was to help organize some meetings for him and his speech in the Turkish parliament. The U.S. government had an opportunity to invite our friends to sit in the top of the parliament building. So we invited groups that the Turkish government, the AKP, didn't necessarily like, so human rights, LGBT groups. And I remember we had a transsexual in the audience, and some of the conservative AKP members saw that person and were somewhat shocked, but there wasn't anything they can do. But when I was there, it was quite a struggle for the LGBT community. How is it for them today?
Yeah, well, it is very hard, but I should also emphasize that how this community has been growing in Turkey. So this has been one of the most serious social changes in Turkey in the last decade. So if you look at the 1990s, even in the most progressive circles, this was not even an issue. I'm not saying, you know, the progressives were anti-LGBT. The issue just didn't exist. Mm-hmm. And now there's a very strong community, and they were actually among the primary fighters in the Gezi protests. They were in the forefront, and they shocked a lot of people. You know, people who are not from progressive circles, but joined the protests because of other agendas, and they have hardly seen LGBT people in their lives, and now that they are fighting shoulder to shoulder with these LGBT people against Erdogan's police, that was also a culturally transformative point in Turkish history. Even though it is politically getting more and more difficult for the community, I would say there is growing social acceptance in one half of Turkey, not the other half, but in one half of Turkey, there is growing social acceptance partially due to this political audacity mm-hmm. during the Gezi protests.
So real polarization in Turkey, although the majority supportive of Erdogan. We have an audience question about the crackdown of journalists and repression against newspapers in Turkey. And I'd like to ask you to comment on this. In my mind, the question is the problem simply Erdogan, or is it something more complex that relates to crony capitalism in Turkey? Mm-hmm. And the background here is that the Turkish newspapers are largely owned by large conglomerates that invest in energy, that invest in construction, And those conglomerates are all very dependent on AKP and Erdogan for approval of permits and other government approvals. And so, of course, that suggests that they would be reluctant to cross Erdogan. So can you flesh out for us why the crackdown on journalists has been happening in Turkey?
First of all, let me give you the regime line. The regime says, yeah, we have a lot of journalists in prison, but they're all terrorists. They're not actually journalists. So they carry journalist cards, identity cards, but they're actually a member of the PKK, the Kurdish guerrilla. Even if you accept that, what you cannot really explain is how all of the, a lot of the independent anti-government voices in the mainstream media working for these conglomerates lost their jobs. Most of the journalists who criticized the government before 2013, especially after the Gezi protests, they one by one lost their jobs, and now many of them don't have real jobs. I mean, they write blogs, they write for e-magazines. Some of them don't have a salary, and then there are these other people who face a trial and prison, and some of them, the people I mentioned who uncovered Turkey's links with al-Nusra, if not necessarily ISIS, everybody knew that they did not belong to the Kurdish guerrilla. So how are you going to make the case for putting them on trial and imprisoning them? Well, the government said they are working as spies. And what's the proof? Uncovering the links between Turkey and the jihadis. I mean, if a journalist doesn't do that, then what is a journalist supposed to do? Right?
Let's go back to Erdogan for a moment. So we talked a bit about how the opposition has been feckless. You touched on how he won the battle against Fethullah Gulen and purged the Gulenists from the government, although we didn't go into detail on that. We talked about how civil society has not really been an effective counterbalance. What Davutoğlu resigned or was forced to resign. What stands in the way of Erdogan now, and if anything, and do you see him continuing to go down this path of autocracy in Turkey and authoritarianism?
Well, honestly speaking, there are only two real political social forces in Turkey. It's the Kurdish guerrilla and it's the AKP, and there's nothing else. And that's Turkey's crisis. Because whatever the Kurdish guerrilla does, I mean, even if, you know, is magically, democratically transformed overnight somehow, it's not going to be able to appeal to an alternative majority, because it's by definition a minority movement. So if only a new majority emerged, Turkey could be saved from authoritarianism by perhaps integrating the Kurds. But the Kurds by themselves cannot save a country from going down this path because they are a minority. I mean, this would be like, you know, putting all of the burden of all of America's problems on just the black population. And the blacks can do a lot of things, but they cannot save the United States from all kinds of evils. This is just an illogical expectation. So. And since this is the situation, you know, this is the only real opposition with a real agenda, there is no other agenda. There is no leftist agenda. There is no liberal agenda. There is simply nothing. And civil society by itself cannot do anything on this front either, because civil society can resist. But in order to present an alternative path, you need a political force. You need an alternative belief, an ideological alternative. So, for example, in Eastern Europe, 1989, civil society was able to bring down the regime and put something in place because there was a global alternative. You know, liberalism was the alternative, and everybody believed in this back then. And you would just implement free market policies, and they would magically resolve everything. So you did not really need a strong political alternative in Eastern Europe at that time. But there's nothing like that. There's no global alternative that almost all intellectuals and all political elites believe in right now that could replace liberal Islam or conservative Islam in Turkey. We are living in an ideological gap. So I don't see this only as a Turkish problem, but it is really a global problem. It is the choice between a degenerating liberalism and strong far-right conservatism that faces us everywhere in the US, in Europe. So, you know, weakening liberalism versus a strengthening far-right.
What would happen if something happened to Erdogan? There has been speculation over the years that he may have some health problems. Would it be a situation like Venezuela where Chavez is gone and there's a power vacuum? Or would the AKP party survive, continue in power? Is there anyone kind of in waiting? It seems like he has set things up so there is no one that has real power other than him.
Yeah, he has really destroyed a lot of people who could take the party over after him, like Bülent Arınç, Abdullah Gül, not Fethullah Gülen quite himself, but his followers, Ahmet Davutoğlu. So yeah, there is no one figure that could replace him. But the problem is, I would not expect the party to evaporate, even if he passes away somehow. Because there are real cadres and an experienced movement out there. I mean, this is not just a one-person show, even though it is tending to go in that direction nowadays.
So we've got just a few more minutes, and I'd like to tie in our discussion of Turkey into what's happening in the U.S. So we are obviously in the midst of presidential election season. It looks increasingly likely that it will be Trump and Clinton. The Obama administration has had an up-and-down relationship with Erdogan in Turkey. President Obama came into office making his first bilateral visit overseas, and you have to phrase it in that way because his first bilateral visit was to Canada. So his first overseas bilateral visit was Turkey. And he saw great hope in the Turkish model, this more secular European liberal system run by a Muslim majority country. And over the years, that relationship hit a number of snags over specific incidents like Turkey voting against Iran sanctions when they were on the UN Security Council. I think it's safe to say in the last two or three years, Obama has very much soured on Erdogan as he has seen this repression of journalists play out. And so I think it's ending on kind of a rocky note, and it's a very transactional relationship. The U.S. needs something from Turkey related to Iraq, and Turkey needs something from the U.S. related to another issue. So I think that's how it will end. How would you see a Trump or a Clinton getting along with Erdogan? Would they change anything about the dynamic between the U.S. and Turkey?
Yeah, I think whoever comes to power next year is going to change everything about the Middle East, because both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are very different from the current president. Clinton would have a much more hawkish stance, and I think it would start with Libya. I mean, it's just a wild guess. More military operations, probably the creation of another Iraq on Libyan soil. So disastrous scenario for much of the Middle East, starting with Libya. I would again, it's an educated guess. Obviously, I can go wrong, but that seems to be the career path of Hillary Clinton. Donald Trump has no path, so it's even more difficult to predict what he would do. But the most likely scenario would be for him to say, just shoot each other. And I'm not joking, even it's just funny, but I think his position, if he has any, is that he wants Muslims to settle it among each other. And by settle, he doesn't mean or intend in peaceful ways, in violent ways. So my guess is that he wants to see this infighting to resolve the issues between the Muslims. So regarding Turkey, though, more straightforward application of this overall framework is that Hillary Clinton would be tying the hands of the Turkish administration, the Turkish regime, just like Obama has been. I mean, it's not, of course, preventing Erdogan from everything he wants to do, but certain things. I mean, you can't just simply go into Syria when Obama or Clinton is in office or another responsible Republican is in office. But if Donald Trump is in office, he might actually not only allow it, he might tell Erdogan to do it. Who knows? Because they have obviously a personality resemblance too, but it's not only that. I mean, his agenda for the Middle East is overall allowing Muslims to settle these issues on their own, very much unlike Hillary Clinton. Mm-hmm.
Cihan, this was a fascinating discussion. I think, as is always the case with Turkey, we could go on for another few hours, but we are out of time. On behalf of World Affairs, I ask you to join me in thanking Cihan Tuğal for this excellent discussion. And many thanks also to you, the audience, for your questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation, too.